Paul Gray was a universalist. He was a mathematician, an engineer, a theoretical physicist, a philosopher of science, and in mathematics, he excelled in all of the disciplines that had existed in his lifetime. Probably the only comparable scientist in his area was Hilbert. He was very clear about making the importance of attention to the invariance of laws of physics, and was one of the first to present the Lorentz transformations in their modern symmetrical form, as opposed to the way Lorentz himself actually did it. He was a professor at France. He ran various ministerial parts of the government. He published volumes on celestial mechanics, electricity, magnetism, wireless telegraphy, and thermodynamics, and had a host of technical articles. He had a best-selling volume on philosophical essays that were highly influential, including to Einstein. By contrast, Einstein at 26 was an unknown patent officer living in a walk-up flat in a modest section of Berkeley. Now, as both his history and his focus on the patent information that came to him, he was immersed in the conversion from local time to coordinated or simultaneous time. And Poincaré came very close to discovering special relativity, but he was too much of a classical physicist to actually be able to succeed. Now, Einstein, on the other hand, focused on Maxwell's field equations and realized that in a vacuum, light would be seen to be constant for all observers. This was something that actually Maxwell never understood himself. Secondly, he was sure that the laws of physics would always have the same form in all inertial frames, that is, non-accelerating frames or freefall frames. Einstein's third paper, usually called special relativity, did a magnificent change about what time and space actually meant. But a couple of years later, it was Einstein's math teacher at BETH, Hermann Minkowski, who showed that a unified space-time was invariant. This invariant is called proper time. And this quantity will be computed to be the same using the coordinates measured by each and every inertial observer. That is the only quantity of space-time that is known by all observers. Now, this unification showed that time is not independent of the observer. Time actually has a different numerical measured value for each inertial observer. Space also has a different numerical measured value for each inertial observer. Space-time has the units of meter, including time. Proper time, the only invariant within space-time, is measured by a co-moving coordinate system. What does that mean? Well, if you are a person and you're wherever you are, your coordinate system is always at the origin. It is where you are, usually the center of mass or something like that. So you are located in space where the XYZ coordinates are all zero. So the only thing that you have going on is time. And proper time is that measured amount of space-time that you progress through. This is a picture of Minkowski's space-time. Now, it's been simplified. There's only two instead of three dimensions, x and y. There would actually have to be three, but I can't do a picture of those. And the line length is minus dt squared plus dx squared plus dy squared. And tau is proper time. So the proper time is a sum of all the terms in space-time, but time has both a conversion factor C, which here is assumed to be 1, and has a negative sign, as opposed to a positive sign, which would mean it was Riemannian. So I'm going to stop at this point and again ask you, do you have any questions about what we've talked about so far?